Thank you for watching my video. My name is Astrid Krasnici. I'm a qualified CCNA and CCNP Cisco trainer. Now, if you're coming back and if you watch section 1.1 and you're coming back, thank you very much. And I hope I'll see you in all the videos that I'm making. Now, if you're watching it for the first time, welcome. This is section 1.2, LANs, WANs, and the Internet. Part of the chapter 1, Exploring the Network. The section CCNA Semester 1, Introduction to Network. Components of network. The path a message takes from a source to destination can be as simple as a single cable connecting one computer to another, or as complex as a network that literally spans the globe, or the internet. There are three categories of the network components. So we have three components on the network infrastructure. We have devices, media, and services. Now, this client here is called a device. This is a switch. Icon for the switch. It's a device. A computer here is called a device. Device here is a printer. So anything you can touch, really, it's pretty much a device. The cables that connect all these together, it's called a media. Media could be fiber optic cable, could be a copper cable, or we could have a wireless. Then we have a services. Services are the software that work inside the devices. For example, devices and media are physical elements or hardware of the network. Network components are used to provide services and processes. These are the communication programs called software that run on the network devices. So software, these are the services that work inside the components or inside the devices. End devices. This PC, for example, is an end device. End device, I want you to imagine an end device every time where the source of the packet starts, for example, or finishes at, it's usually the end device. So a source is probably a client machine here, goes through, the packet goes through the switch and gets ends here. That's an end device as well. So you have end devices, the PCs, laptops, computers, network printers, voice over IP phones, telepresence endpoints, security cameras, mobile handheld devices. These are all end devices. Another name for it are called hosts. Out there in live networks, most of the people, they call them hosts, not end devices. But Cisco is insisting on end devices, so that's a good term for you to remember. Stick with Cisco, they know what they're doing. These devices form the interface between users and underlying communication on the network. A host device is either the source or destination of the message transmitted over the network. So it's either going to be the source or the destination, and that's an end device. In order to distinguish one host from another host, each host in the network is identified by an address. So each of these devices, they have IP addresses, right? Like names, like we have names, human beings, we have names, but the network devices, they have IP addresses. Network infrastructure devices. So intermediary devices interconnect end devices. For example, this is intermediary device. This connects two end devices together. Intermediary devices connect the individual host to the network and can connect multiple individual networks to form an internet network. So if I connect this, my network, small network, if I connect another small networks, and I connect another small networks, and I connect another small networks, we are making it, it's becoming a big network. So intermediary devices, they connect, they do that. Example of intermediary network devices are network access, we have switches, wireless access points, internetworking, these are routers, security, these are firewalls. Processes running on the intermediate device, network device, perform these functions. Regenerate and retransmit data signal. So, if the packet comes from this switch or frame up to this switch, from this end device up to this intermediate device is going to regenerate and retransmit the data signal. So, when it leaves the cable here, imagine it's wireless, yeah? The packet is degraded, the quality. So this device here was regenerated and retransmitted. Maintain information about what paths exist through the network and internetwork. So for example, the routers, they will maintain which path to take to another destination or to another network. And if one of the network goes down or is for example, experience like a bandwidth issues or something, will not be able to notify other devices of error and communication failures. And direct data along alternate paths when there is a link failure. For example, if one route fails, well, router will choose another route to send it to the destination. The third type is, the second type. These were the devices, yeah? So we had devices. So we have two types of devices. We have end devices and intermediary devices. Then we have a media. There's three types of media. First is metallic wire within the cables. That's a copper. The second, the glass or plastic fiber optic. And third is wireless transmission. Communication across the network is carried on a medium. The medium provides a channel over in which a message travels from the source to destinations. So we see that we have three types of media. On metallic wires, the data is encoded into electrical impulses that match a specific pattern. So we use the copper wires and we encode in the electrical impulses. In fiber optic, the transmission relies on pulses of light. So we send a light beam, with either infrared lights or visible light ranges. In wireless transmission, patterns of electromagnetic waves depict the various bit values. So in wireless, we send the waves. The network representation. So here we have some icons for end devices, and then we have icons for intermediary devices, and we have a different icons for network media. For example, net end device, this is a desktop computer, easy to identify, laptop, easy to identify, printer, yep, IP phone, yep, tablet, wireless tablet, yep, telepresence endpoint, TV, yep. Intermediary devices, this is the icon for wireless router. Now I want you to actually pay attention to these devices, because later on we'll just put the device there and expect you to know what device is. This is LAN switch, which is a little bit less, is a bit cheaper, works in layer 2 than multi-layer switch. This is like a bit switch and a router mixed in one device. And then we have a router, that's the router, no switch in there. And then we have a firewall appliance. And the network media, this is a representation for wireless, LAN, and wide area network media. So when conveying a complex information, such as displaying all the devices and medium, in a large internet network, it is helpful to see visual representation, or to use visual representation. A diagram provides an easy way to understand the way the devices in a large network are connected. Such as diagrams use a symbol to represent the different devices and connection that make up a network. This type of picture of a network is known as a topology diagram. We have two kinds of topology diagrams. We have a physical topology diagram and a logical topology diagram. Physical, it's actually how the cables are laid. So we have, for example, the admin office here. They have two computers and a printer. We put the cables up to the switch and how everything is laid in the network. Logical representation is how the data will travel. For example, here we have three physical servers with the cables and everything. Here we just got name of the server, mail server for example, and the IP address. And they are connected to our network through this switch. Okay, so we have a physical topology diagram and logical topology diagram. For example, a physical topology would be something that is exactly the way it is. I don't know, we have an underground station. Sometimes I tell my students that I compare it to London underground stations or tube map. The stations are nicely apart from each other, right? When we look at it, that's a logical representation. Yeah, because they will fit nicely in the map. But in reality, one station from another has a lot different. One station to another, maybe there's 10 seconds. From one station to another station, there's, I don't know, 2-3 minutes. So in the physical representation is totally, totally different to our what we used to logical representation. So we have a different type of networks. Two most common type of networks are local area network, LAN, a network infrastructure that provides access to our users and end devices in a small geographical area. In small geographical area, it's called LAN. For example, a room, a small office, or your home. That's a LAN, local area network. Wide area network, or WAN, a network infrastructure that provides access to other networks over a wide geographical area. Here is the geographical area we're talking about. If it's very small, then it's LAN. If you connect two LANs together through a wide area, then it's going to be wide area network, or large wide geographical area. We have three other types of that we need to know here. Other types of networks: metropolitan area networks, or MAN, a network infrastructure that spans a physical area larger than LAN but smaller than WAN. For example, I don't know, university campus is like a MAN, a metropolitan area network. Then we have a wireless LAN, same as LAN but wireless. And then we have another type of network that you should know. It's called storage area network, or SAN. A network infrastructure designed to support file servers and provide data storage, retrieval, and replication. Now, storage area network is only about storage, hard disk, terabytes and terabytes and terabytes and petabytes and exabytes of hard disks. And for LAN to connect, or WAN to connect to these areas, storage area network, is to access that storage. Obviously, you want to connect with a really fast connection like fiber optic or something. So local area network, or network infrastructure that spans a small geographical area, like we said. Specific features of LAN include LAN, interconnect and devices in limited areas such as home, school, office building, or campus. LAN is usually administered by a single organization or individual, like you. At home, you are the administrator of your LAN. The administrative control that governs the security and access control policies are enforced on the network level. So you are in control of your house LAN. And you can control the policies and access control and whatever you want on your local area network. LAN provides a high-speed bandwidth to internal and devices and intermediary devices. So LANs are usually very, very high speed, 100 Mbps. That's quite high, quite fast. Wide area network, or WAN, are a network infrastructure that spans a wide geographical area. They are typically managed by service provider, internet service providers. Specific features of WAN include wide area network interconnects LANs over wide geographical such areas, such as between cities, state, and provinces, countries, or continents. So we are connecting, here we have a LAN, connect to another LAN, to another LAN. So we are connecting lots of LANs on a wide area. WANs are usually administered by multiple service providers. Wide area network typically provides slower speed links between local area networks. And then the biggest network that we have is internet. Internet work, although there are benefits to using a LAN and WAN, most individuals need to communicate with resources on another network outside of the local network. Now, if I just leave you home, so imagine you just at home, you're doing the file transfer, you're doing, I don't know, printing or whatever you're going to do at home. After a while, that's it, you're stuck. So really, what we'd use the networks is to access other companies, right, outside our network. So when we want to access someone outside, then we use internet. The internet is not owned by individual group. So nobody owns the internet. It's just lots of little companies put together, or little, or big, or medium-sized companies put together, they're communicating with each other. But nobody's really in charge. But we have some agencies that kind of like use standardization of internet protocols and processes so they can make it these companies talking to each other easier. These organizations include Internet Engineering Task Force, IETF, Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, ICANN, and Internet Architecture Board, I, plus many others. So Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, these are your IP addresses, where you buy your IP addresses. Without IP address, you can't communicate on the public network. The two other types of networks that we have is intranet and extranet. So they're very, very similar. Intranet is very similar to internet, but the difference is huge. Internet is public, means that everybody will be able to access it. Intranet, on the other hand, is private. It's only authorized users will be able to access the intranet. So for example, say you have a web page, ABC, your company. Now ABC will be able to access, you want it to be accessed by public, so they can come and buy stuff that you are selling. But same time, ABC, you want your workers or your organization member staff to be able to access it so they can update that website. So where public, they access at abc.com, is public or internet. Where your staff access that abc.com, it's intranet, it's private. Another type of network is extranet. Extranet is when you provide the secure and safe access to individuals who work for a different organization but require company data. Examples include providing access to suppliers, contractors, and so on. It's like a trust relationship. You're building a trust with another company so they can come to your company and check part of your, I don't know, website or internet or part of your network. For example, imagine that your company, I don't know, abc.com makes cars. Now you're going to make a part of your network for someone who supplies tires to you to come and check whether you need tires or not. Or another part of the network, I don't know, light bulbs or whatever. It's like you give specific arrangement for another, for a supplier or another network to be to come and check your network. Now that network is not internet, so public users cannot access it, but it's not intranet either, so that private users cannot come in there and say, because I don't care, your staff doesn't really care how many tires you have, but suppliers do, so that's extranet. Different ways we have to connect remote users to the internet. Now I want you to imagine that you moved house, you got a new house, you went there, first thing you want to do, okay, if you have kids like me, first thing you need to do is subscribe or get the internet, be online, right? So you have to ask now, okay, what's my choices? First choice that you can have is cable. Cable is offered by a service provider that do offer the TV. They use the same coaxial cable to deliver the TV signal and the cable signal for the internet. Now, that's not always available. So if you phone, for example, here we have the Virgin Media. That's our cable provider. If you phone them, if in my street there's no cable, laid already there, that's it. They will turn around and say, no, I'm sorry, you have to wait for a little bit online. That's first method. Second method is DSL. Now DSL, if you have a phone line, you can have a DSL. So if I phone one of the ISPs here, for example, BT or Sky or O2, these are our ISPs. Ah, O2 is coming down. Now it's only Sky, I think Sky one. If I phone them, they're going to ask me, oh, do you have a phone line? Yes, I do. Okay, great. As long as it's not too far from our exchange, it's great. You can have a DSL. So DSL uses a signal of the telephone line to send the DSL signal as well. Now DSL is separated in three channels. One channel is to send the voice voice telephone calls. The second channel is faster download channel. And the third channel is for sending or uploading information. So that's why you divide it on three different separate channels, the DSL. Okay, imagine that you don't have the cable, you can't have the cable because the ISP hasn't put the cable next to your street. You can't have a DSL because you don't have the phone line. What's the other choices? Well, the other choice is phone, mobile phone. Cellular, internet access using cell phone network connect. So we have like 3G, 4G here available. We can use that to connect to the internet. Like I said, already a couple of years ago, I moved the house and we went to the new house. And there was no internet because of some problems. Anyway, there was a 2 weeks delay or something, and I was using the mobile. But okay, the mobile did work. It was fast, but it was, I don't know, 10 GB a month or something like that. I used that in a day, so that was not good. The other method is satellite. Satellite service is good option for homes or offices that do not have access to DSL or cable. So if you live in the middle of woods somewhere, well, not too many woods because it needs a line, clear line. The satellite needs a clear line. Then you're gonna have, that's a good choice. Satellite internet is a good choice. And the last and most reliable option is the dial-up. Dial-up uses a phone line, but it doesn't have that modem or that splitter. They can split the channel between DSL and phone line. So if you're using dial-up for data transfer, that's it. You can't phone anyone. You'll be using the dial-up range or area, so you can't. It's not split. Dial-up. I don't know if you remember. I don't know how young you are, but me, I was using dial-up, I don't know, 95 or 96. It was really slow, but it seems fast there. It was something like, I don't know, they were advertising 56 kilobytes per second, but we used to get like 28 kilobytes per second was the average. And that was good. Seemed really good. Very fast. And you had to dial ISP, so you could hear the dialing, and then you hear the weird noise, and then you were connected. And we were paying something like 1p a minute, I think it was. But anyway, if you stayed all day online, like it wasn't always on, yeah? So if you were staying all day, that pennies got really expensive. Now the businesses that connect to the internet a bit differently. they require, for example, different requirements than the users. For us, as long as we connect to the internet, we have a fast download. Okay, the upload, we don't really care about upload, then we okay. Businesses, no. Businesses want guarantees, for example. Okay, well, if I'm a user and I phone the supplier, ISP, they will tell me something like up to 8 megabytes per second. But then I'll probably get 2 or 3 and they'll be okay with it. They will fight the corners, oh, you're too far from the exchange and all that. The businesses, no. The businesses, they want the data. Okay, it's like guarantee. Say, okay, I'm going to have 1.54 megabits per second. That's it. Not going to go less than that. So you lease lines. So when we connect to the internet, for example, that's a public network, which means that everybody who sees that, who can see our packets, will be able to, anybody could get our packets. Now, with the lease line, it's a private network. You are leasing your own line, right? And these are the speeds that you can be leasing. You can have T1, which is very, very popular, 1.54 megabits per second, or T3 in America, 44.7 megabits per second. These are like quite a few T1s put together, 23. And in the Europe, for example, we can have E1, which is 2 megabits per second, or E3, 34 megabits per second. Then other methods are Metro Ethernet. Metro Ethernet is becoming very, very popular because they use fiber and copper, dedicated copper or fiber, and they provide really fast speed. 10 Mbps up to 10 gigabit per second. Then we have other options, our DSL, same as what we use for as a user, but this time we are not using asymmetric, so not different, no like faster download and slower upload. Businesses, they want same symmetric digital subscriber line, which means same speed for upload and same speed for download, because businesses are really concerned with upload than download. They don't search the website like we do for something. They are the servers. We are searching from them, so they want to give it to us like the website as quickly as possible. With ADSL, you have to remember that maximum distance is 18,000 feet or 5,488 meters. So we can't, if we live further than that from the exchange, then they're gonna turn around and say, okay, well, no, we can't have the DSL and so on. Further you are, slower the speeds. Closer you are, faster the speeds. And then we have a satellite. Satellite services, a service can provide the connection when a wire solution is not available. So again, same thing. If we don't have DSL or we don't have Metro Ethernet, we can't have a dedicated, we can always rely on satellite. There's always going to be a satellite, right? The one thing about satellite is you have to remember, you have to have a clear line of sight. Okay, we finished section 1.2. Now I'm going to do a demonstration. Initializing and reloading a router and a switch. Now for this, I'm going to use a packet tracer. So I'm just going to open my packet tracer. Right. I'm going to configure the router and a switch, right? And do a very, very quick configuration. I'm not going to explain to you that because that's in chapter 2. But I'm going to show you how you will reload it, or how you will put it like a factory reset. Here are routers. So for example, here I have a different options of routers. In class, we use 1941, right? And for the switches, 2960, right? That's one router and one switch. That's your course, routing and switching. Now I'm gonna use two end devices, a PC this side, and a laptop maybe on this side. Okay, same thing, end device. Now, to connect from PC to the router doesn't have anything that you can click on it, or there's no display or anything. So you really have to have the console cable to connect this PC to this router. And then on this PC, you have to have an emulation program that will be able to access that router. Emulation programs are like, I don't know, TeraTerm, PuTTY, there's some free ones, Secure CRT, you have to pay for it, and so on. Connection, and a select connection, they automatically choose connection. Don't select that. Don't ever choose that. You want to know exactly what cable you're using. So I'm going to use a console cable. This is the cable that we need, right? These are like brand new routers. Came out of the factory now. So I click on the PC, select RS232. That's my serial port. Don't select fast Ethernet, because we're not going to send any data through the normal bandwidth. We're just going to select out of band connection, RS232 serial port, select that, and then go all the way to the router and choose a console port. Right, I'm gonna do the same for the switch. The switch console might run out of the window, but we see. So laptop, RS232. Sometimes the laptops don't have the serial port. If they don't have the serial port, you can always have the converter. One converter that converts serial to USB port. Okay, RS232. And on the switch, I know it's out of the screen, but it's console. I'm connecting to the console port. Okay, so now I open this PC. And let me just zoom in a little bit. Not zoom in, but expand this. Go to desktop. Then see, there's a terminal emulator program here. Not a command prompt, terminal emulator. I select that. Then this terminal configuration, there is like a port configuration. 9600 bits per second speed. Data bits 8, parity none. Stop bits 1, flow control none. Always a default, but you have to remember these numbers. Click OK. As you can see, now I got a window, or I can access my router. I can see what the router is saying. Now, when you have a brand new router, you will see this. Let me move this a little bit. Okay, you will see this. Continue with the configuration dialog, which means there's a brand new router or factory reset router. So no, that's gonna open a wizard. If I say yes, it's gonna open a wizard, and it's gonna go through asking me lots of different questions. Do you wanna do this? Do you wanna do this? So on and so on. Enter the name and so on. We're not ready for that. And the Cisco CCNA routing and switching does not test you on this. And they don't, you can try it, but they don't really, they're not concerned whether you know or not. Okay, so enter the name and so on. To stop this, I press Control key simultaneously, the keys. That's it, I'm stopped. Now, I'm gonna configure the router a little bit, right? So I'm gonna give it a name, so host name, R1, right? So configure terminal, enable, and configure terminal, and I give it a name. So now the name, you can see it's changed from router to R1, right? And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna save it. So I'm gonna give it a password as well. So enable secret class, right? In Cisco studies, you're always gonna use either class or Cisco, right? That's it. That's it. Two stuck with those two passwords. Not on real life. On real life, please use minimum 8 characters, mixture, uppercase, lowercase, numbers, different, everything you can, as much as you can. You can mix them 2-3 words together, all that. Okay, for now we're going to use class, and we're going to save this configuration. So copy, running config to startup config. Startup config. Which means that when we power cycle this router, which means we reload, restart the router, the configuration we did is still going to be there. So let's try that. Reload. So now the router is going through the decompressing the iOS or the operating system and reloading the router. But you remember the question we had already? It's not going to ask us that. Okay, let's just wait till it reloads. Okay, now the router has reloaded. I have to press enter there. Sometimes you have to press enter to get your prompt. You remember the question that we had early? It's down here. This is the question. Continue with the configuration dialog, right? The reason why it's not asking us that anymore is because there is a startup configuration file. So for us to factory reset this router, we have to be able to go inside the router. So this was class. When I enter the passwords, you see it doesn't show the characters that I'm entering for security reasons. Okay, so to factory reset this router, you say erase, startup, config, enter, and reload. Right? That's it. Very, very simple, but we have pretty much factory reset this router. Now, if you don't know the password, like that password that we had earlier, that's a method to recover the password as well, which you will learn later. So again, you see that message, which means there's nothing, there's no configured, there's no configuration or a startup configuration. Okay, we're gonna do the same for the switch. So I'll go to the laptop. Let me just adjust it so we can all see it. Okay, I go to desktop here, then terminal. Remember these? Okay, done. I'm in the switch. You see on the switch, I'm not getting that message. But still, there's nothing on the startup. So if I go enable, that's a shortcut for enable, yeah. So disable again, enable, show startup, config, and I say, okay, there's nothing on. There's no startup on. Right? So what we're going to do now, we're going to just configure the name. So here we say hostname SW1. So you see the name has changed. And we give a password. So enable secret class. Okay, and one more thing I want to do here. I want to create some VLANs. So VLAN 10, VLAN 20. To see the VLANs, again, don't panic. You're going to learn about VLANs later on. Show VLAN brief. I see. Okay, VLAN 10 and VLAN 20. Okay, and I'm going to save this configuration. So copy running config to startup config. Okay, these VLANs are not saved on the NVRAM. So if when we erase the startup config, these VLANs are not going to be erased. We see that why? Because they are saved somewhere else. So reload. Now there is a configuration. So we should see SW1 instead of switch and so on. Okay, let's just wait till it reloads. Okay, press enter or press return to get started. So you can see this doesn't say SW1. Enable, and we are challenged with the password. Password is class. Okay, excellent. We are in the switch now. So to factory reset, erase, startup, config, and reload. Now, when it reloads, it's not going to say, well, it shouldn't say SW1 like it did up there. Sorry, SW1. Okay, it's going to say switch. Yep, great. So it means that it did work. But if I don't show VLAN brief, my VLANs are still there. It didn't erase these. The reason is because there's two parts of erasing on the switch or factory reset. For example, for router, all you have to do is erase startup config. Config and then reload. Done. That's factory reset for the router. For switch, on the other hand, you have to do the same like this. Erase startup config. But before you do reload, you have to do delete VLAN.dat, which means I want to delete these VLANs as well. So the factory reset is for the switch, actually three commands. For the router, is two commands. So I delete VLAN.dat. Delete VLAN.dat. You sure? Flash, confirm it? Yeah. And then reload. So now, once we reload, there shouldn't be any VLANs anymore in there. And there shouldn't be anything on the startup configuration. We're gonna check both. So we're gonna do show startup config. Okay, it says not present. Did work, so we did delete it. Show VLAN brief. And now my VLANs are gone. These are the default VLANs, so they're always gonna be one. Sorry, they're always gonna be there, which is VLAN 1 and four other VLANs as well. But VLAN 10, which we had early in 20, which I created, they're gone. They've been deleted. See? These two. They're no more there. So if I go down, they're no more there. Okay, so that was demonstration of initializing and reloading a router and the switch. And I'll see you in section 1.3, the networking as platform. Thank you very much for watching. See you in the next videos. Bye.